next, we have Remy Bertot with Passbolt Open Source Password Manager for Teams.
Thanks, everyone. I just wanted to, maybe we could give a little round of applause to Elena and David, who has been running this room. Thanks a lot for volunteering and organizing this. It's really nice from you. So I'm Remy Bertot. You may remember me from other open source projects, minor and horrible contributions to Mailvelope, Open Social, and some other events that we do. But here today, I'm here to reprise my role as the co-founder of Passbolt. Before we start, I just wanted to show you this picture, which was taken 20 years ago. I think we can appreciate the amount of swag in this picture. If there are Gen Z in the room, 20 years ago, Facebook didn't exist, so we didn't know that this picture will come back to haunt us. So is anyone not using a password manager at work? Can you raise your hand? Okay, I can see the Passbolt developer raising their hand. We need to have a little talk about this after. But for the other ones that raised their hands, I would like you to meet with me after, because I want to learn how you do to live without fear. So this is what we did. We built an open source password manager that is designed for collaboration. So you can share secrets with your teams. So you have granular access and permissions to every single resources and folders. It's available by default in the browsers. So it's designed specifically for collaboration. So as many password managers, we also have like a quick access, so you can basically see this little annoying icon in every single form when you browse the web. We also have like Android and iOS applications, so it works with biometrics, and you also have multi-accounts. So for example, if you have a personal account and a professional account on the same phone, then you can basically use both. They work with the autofill as well, so it's like automatically fill the form for you based on the API that is available by the phone. And since you guys are most likely developers, we also offer command line interface and SDKs. So if you have curl and GPG, you can pretty much talk to Passbolt and like pipe the output of the curl request to GPG and decrypt the content. So like it's pretty low footprint when it comes to like working with the API. We also have like Ansible plugins and like tutorials on how to integrate this into your GitLab pipelines. So basically you can use it as a secret manager, not just as a password manager for your team. You can also store like credentials for machine-to-machine authentication if you want. We also provide, one of the goals of Passbolt is to make sure that administrator of a Passbolt instance do not have to do a lot of work. So like we provide native packages for Linux distribution, pretty much all major distributions, and we keep adding some of them. Like this year we did the Helm chart. So if you're one of the cool kids and you use Kubernetes, you can basically get started with Passbolt as well. It's really low maintenance. We have like people running Passbolt for years and not updating them, and then updating them to the last version with just one command. So like we try to make your life easy. Obviously, we are not the only password manager in the space. So like a lot of people come to me and are like, oh, how are you different from this and that? So main difference with KeePass is like KeePass is a file. So like we are like an API and we do user management. So KeePass is great if you basically want offline access or if you don't want to share data. If you share with KeePass, you're gonna have some issues with concurrent access and versioning. But it's great if you do not want to have any metadata and you just want a file and everything is encrypted. So like KeePass is really great there. Compared to Vaultwarden and Bitwarden, we have like basically different security properties. Like we use a completely random private key. With Bitwarden, for example, the encryption strength is depending on the password that is selected by the end user. So there are other password managers like 1Password that use a private key, but basically we are the only other one that does this. We require the browser extension. So this is also a key differentiator, is that you must install Passbolt browser extension. Why? Is in case the server is compromised, an attacker cannot change the application. So they cannot change, for example, the cryptographic functions or like add some code to extract the decrypted materials. So this is one big difference. So when you access a Passbolt instance, you feel like it's a website, but it's actually not a website. It's an iframe that is inserted in the page, and the server cannot basically access what is in that iframe. So it's basically a change of architecture. And we support, as I said, like nested folders with flexible permissions. Like in Bitwarden, you basically create collections and you put items in them. And we basically support like granular sharing and granular secret management. So for example, the secrets in Passbolt are encrypted once per person, so that, for example, if somebody leaves the organization, we are able to provide revocation. So it's not like we other password manager, which will have like a symmetry key that is shared with many users, and they will not rotate that key for the collection. So obviously, Bitwarden support features that we don't have. So like that's why people adopt Bitwarden. But what happened in 2023? So one of the major events of 2023 that we had is our site of the head of site reliability management at Passbolt got married. So we thought it will never happen, but like maybe we can give him a little round of applause for getting hitched. Well done, Diego. No, seriously, this year we shipped a single sign-on with OpenID, Microsoft, and Google. And I'm very pleased to announce that the OpenID connector will be soon available in the community edition. Both community edition and the pro edition are completely open source, so they are both under AGPL. The pro edition will require you to pay something, but obviously it's open source software, so you can do as you please. So we also shipped another interesting feature, which is like TOTP, which allows you to store your TOTP code into Passbolt and share them. So should you put your password and your TOTP code in the same application, it is up for you to decide. It's interesting, for example, if you want to share them, but you know, if you don't want to put all your eggs in the same basket, I will understand. But the same way, like you need to look at all the risks. For example, if you use the Google Authenticator, if you have the sync enabled across device, your TOTP code are not end-to-end encrypted, so you might want to have that as well. We did also passbolt.exe. That's not like my pet project, but like the 80% of the users of Passbolt are on Windows, so like obviously this is something that they wanted. We plan to support more OS in the future, but like we started with the biggest chunk. So it's a native app. It's not like a like a JavaScript application disguised as an app. It's a native app. We did that for security reason, because there are some properties when you use Electron that are like not so great. So we basically like spend a lot of time building that up last year. We did also a lot of other things. So we did some performance improvement. We changed the grid so you can select which columns are there or not. We introduced some role-based access control for UI. So for example, if you want your users to have less features, then you can just remove everything and feel like it's 2005 again. Then we have also suspend users. So you can, for example, if Diego is going on honeymoon and you want to disable his access, then you can do that. And we have a lot of policies that were rolled out, like so you can control what is the strength of a password by default, how long should the passphrase to protect the private key, that sort of things. So we also had four security audits, one on LDAP, one on SSO, one on our network, and one on our internal controls and processes. So we didn't have any major issues, but if you are curious, like the reports are available on our incident page, and all the audits were made by Cure 53, so like basically it's legit. So what's cooking for 2024? I mean, it was supposed to be released in 2023, so this is coming next week. It's a password expiry. So when somebody, for example, leave an organization or leave a group, or if you remove a permission on somebody's access to a secret, then this feature will mark automatically a password as needed to be rotated. So this way, like as people come and go and access systems, you know which credentials needs to be rotated. I think it's pretty interesting feature when it comes to security. And for organizations that are like masochist, you can also set policies and like, for example, say I want all my credentials to be rotated every 40 days and make my employees' life a nightmare. You can do that. We also redesigned the admin panel. So, I mean, it's not like a lot of work, but like I still think it's neat. And we have a lot of stuff coming. Also, in the 4.6, we have SSO with ADFS. Again, like Microsoft, but. All right, and then we have a bunch of performance improvements. So we have people telling us, okay, I have 12,000 secrets that are shared with 200 people, and it's slow. I'm like, at this point, is it really a secret? I don't know. But we're gonna try to make your life a little less miserable. And we're gonna have icons, custom fields, a bunch of other things like that are missing in the software right now, like file attachment and notes. And we have 7 babies scheduled. So for a team of 40, we have like, I don't know what happened last year. I think like the summer of love of Passbolt. What is it made of? So the secret ingredient is love. I'm not going to spend a lot of time, but it's basically a simple PHP LAMP stack and with a web extension on top. So the application is split into multiple projects. The Passbolt API, which is based in PHP. Why PHP is because any administrator in their life have hosted some PHP, so it's pretty easy to use and like low maintenance, it's very stable. And we have the web extension on top, which is like split into two. We have a React app, which controls the UI, and we have what we call the background page, which is a separate application. And the front end and the back end talk through a series of API. This is to make sure that anything phishing and happening on the front end can be controlled. So we have like a choke point where we can define like, is it normal for the front end to do these kind of things? So if you want to look at the JSON API, we have basically documentation online. And if you want to look at the style guide, it's based on Storybook. So basically you can add or customize your teams without having to build the entire thing. And this is how we split the work. You know, we have people working on the front end and we have people working on the back end as well. So I'm not gonna take questions, but one of the things I wanted to tell you is that at 2 o'clock, we will be next to the bar and we will be like spinning the wheel like we did last year. And this year, the prize is a picture of Mackie, which is our office dog. It's my prized possession. So if you want to come get it, it's at 2 in front of the bar. Thank you very much.